Namaskaram. Namaskaram, dear one. Wow. As days go by, the virus death toll is rising, though in some countries it's a bit contained. Many of the new regions in the world running away. Unfortunately, United States has crossed over 30,000 or 32,000 deaths here. They gave me a lesser number, I don't know why. The news is saying 32,000. The last 24 hours, over 2,500 people just in one country, largely focused probably in a couple of states. Spain, 19,000. Italy, nearly 22,000. France, over 17,000. UK, 13,000. Iran, 5,000. Over 2 million people infected by the virus. 137,000 people killed in the world. And I'm sure the real number is at least 10-20% more than this. Well, people who have other conditions, like cardiac conditions, those on immunoblockers and other people, the earliest symptoms of the virus, they may die. But that's not being attributed to the virus, but attributed to their other ailments that they already had. But without the virus, probably they would have lived much longer with their existing problems. So, in the last 24 hours, nearly 6,500 people have died in the world just of the virus. In India, we've crossed 422 people dead till now, 28 just in the last 24 hours. Worst day for United States, last 24 hours, as far as the virus is concerned. Over 22 nations have crossed 10,000 mark in terms of infections or confirmed cases. India slowly emerging as among the top 5 nations which have maximum amount of testing. From lockdown, we are quite efficiently moving into large-scale testing, which is the right direction to take. Kerala, UP, Tamil Nadu has less than 1% mortality rate for whatever reported cases, which I feel was expected. I told you many days ago that southern Indian people may have a little better resistance to this simply because of the food and their closeness to the land and also a certain aspect of their genetics. The percentage has remained low, that's very good. In Tamil Nadu, the lockdown is very effective. 170 hotspots have been recognized and locked down. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, that was for India. In Tamil Nadu, 22 red districts, that is high concentration. Well, slowly more and more facts about the resilience of the virus is coming through. Now they're saying it's not necessarily because of physical distance that it jumps from one person to another. It can happen through the air conditioning systems. So, air travel and even to some extent rail travel will be a challenge, because without air conditioning you can't run these transports. Hospitals which are air conditioned could be very efficiently distributing the virus to everybody. Well, nothing is really confirmed, but nothing is in a state where we can deny it. Challenging times, for sure. The economy across the world looking quite grim in many places. If we get back into economic activity at least by mid-May or June, maybe in 6 to 9 months we should be chugging along, not at the level of economic well-being that we knew, but reasonably well. But if it takes much more time to get agriculture, industry and businesses to buzz once again, then we are looking for hard times for at least 24 months, 18 to 24 months probably. Many nations, will they be able to get out of it for a long period of time is a question mark. As far as India is concerned, in the last 20 years, we have moved over 240 million people out of poverty. So this virus, lockdowns and downgrading of economy could push these people straight back into below the poverty line once again, which is very unfortunate, because it took decades of striving to bring them out of poverty and again back. This is not going to be good for education, for the lower strata, economic strata in any society, particularly in a country like India. It'll be bad for women. When the economy goes bad, even within the family, whoever is more vulnerable gets the maximum beating, unfortunately. Well, it's taken a huge effort to put the girl child into school in this country. Today, a very high percentage of girls, very high, probably better than most nations, even in rural India, are in schools. Well, this could undo a lot of that work. What extent, nobody knows, but definitely it will undo that. A lot of things that need to be built back, putting us back by I don't know how long. Challenges are there. I hope as human beings we become far more resilient than the virus and bounce back with vigor, bounce back with great enthusiasm and strength, because we are number one in the evolutionary scale of things on this planet, this is the time to prove it. How consciously, with how much intelligence and resilience we can bounce back. I think this is a test for who we are in many ways. It's a kind of war-like situation, but nobody is shooting at us. That is the grace. At least nobody is bombing our homes down, nobody is burning us out of where we live. If we are conscious and careful, we live. If we are little arrogant, there is a price to pay.
This question is from Rama Devi Karu. Namaskaram Sadhguru. You have mentioned many times in your talks about science of God making. I really found those words very fascinating, but never understood what you mean by this. Can you explain about it more in detail?
Rama Devi Garu, obviously, Telugu speaking lady, she has a deep desire to get me into trouble. Because God is explosive material, those who meddle with it usually get killed by those people who believe they are God's soldiers. If God is omnipotent and powerful enough to make this inexhaustible creation, I don't think he would hire you as a soldier. Puny little thing you are. Well, you can cause damage to another human being, and of course other animals, plants, trees. If you stand here on this tiny little planet, freak and fret and throw even your nuclear damn bomb, nothing happens in the cosmos. You are too puny. You are. So, I don't think Creator would hire you as a soldier. So, let us examine Rama Devi Garu's desire. Please have the courage to look at this in a very fundamental way. Let us say, before human beings came upon this planet, well, a whole lot of stupid people believe the world started only with human beings. Well, today even a school-going child knows that's not the case. The world, the creatures, the plants, the trees, and the cockroaches, they were here well ahead of you, a billion years ahead of you. So when there were no human beings, do you believe there was God on planet Earth? Even now, if all of us, entire humanity, if we go to sleep for 2 hours, everybody, you think there is God somewhere? It's a product of human mind. God as we know it, I'm saying. Obviously, you and me did not create this cosmos, that we know. But this idea there is a big man sitting up there and doing all this. He's a product of a childish mind. It's a man, I want the ladies to remember. Rama Devi Garu, I want you to remember, it's a man. Fortunately in this culture, because we are conscious, it is we who make the gods. For the sake of gender parity, we made male gods and female gods. Everywhere else where they believe God is really up there and He makes you, there is only male God, you better understand that. So in this country, we mastered the technology of God making. What does that mean? First of all, this is a culture which doesn't have an idea of the God. There is no the God. All the people you worship are icons of the past. You take Shiva, Rama, Krishna, whoever else, a Buddha, whatever. These are all people who walked this land at one time, went through all the drama of life, struggles and tribulations, more than you do. But because they became so iconic, we looked up to them as an inspiration to live better, which is natural among human beings, to look up to something which will upgrade you. Something is better than you, you look up to that so that you can upgrade yourself, that aspiration is fine. But inventing things and then believing this is it, is the tragedy of humanity, because essentially this comes from a fundamental level of dishonesty, that you are not willing to see whatever you do not know as I do not know, lack of humility and honesty. Everything that you do not know, you believe. The moment you say, I believe, we must be careful, because what you believe is more sacred than reality itself. What you believe is more important than the existence itself. What you believe is more important than the very phenomena of life around you, because it is your belief. So your belief is even bigger than the creation and the creator, of course. No, 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 let me change the term. If I say creator, see, you also, Sadhguru, believe? Well, language is limited in expression, we can say the source of creation. Source is also a wrong word because you would think it's in one place. But it is a fact that you or me did not create this existence. It was here before you came and I came. Don't blame me for this, okay? I didn't do this. Now, having said that, what is the purpose of God making? First of all, the word God, the God, never existed in this country. We are only looking at how to make things work. Because in this culture, you've always been told your life is your karma. Karma means you're doing. When I say, this is my karma, what it means is, this is my making. My life is my karma means, my life is my making. It's beautiful, it's my making. It's ugly, it's my making. I am right now joyful, this is my making, I am miserable, this is my making. Understanding that the way you are experiencing your life right now is entirely your making. Now, people have gotten into this mode, but somebody is rich, somebody is poor, why is it like this, is it my making, you… he was born in a rich family, I was born in a poor family. See, this rich, poor, all this nonsense is only because you're comparing yourself with somebody. If you sit here, your experience of life is entirely your making. Physical arrangement of things is about the times in which we live, is geographical locations in which we are born, those are not important. Even a caveman who probably was always under lockdown of his own, social distancing because there was nobody around, he also knew the same sort of joy and misery as you know. Not because stock market went up, stock market came down. Today he had a good hunt, he's like this. Tomorrow he's searching, he did not find anything, he's stressed and miserable. In terms of experience of human life, nothing has changed. Individual people are either joyful or miserable, pleasant or unpleasant. Because we held the subjective dimension of life far more important than the physical arrangement of life around us, we largely describe the quality of life as a subjective dimension, because your experience of life is the quality of your life. What kind of home you live in, what kind of clothes you wear, how much money you got in the bank, virus is not checking all this, hello? If it gets you, you can't breathe. Oh, he's got a lot of money, let's leave him alone. No such exemptions. Because this is the nature of life. So that is how we're looking at it. It doesn't matter what physical arrangements you have, how joyful you are, how miserable you are, how pleasant is your experience of life, how unpleasant is it, is your karma. So knowing this, we started devising tools with which we can enhance our experience of life. Because we understood that this body itself is a mechanism, this human mechanism, we understood, is a better mechanism than that of a cockroach, a better mechanism than that of a dog, a better mechanism than even that of a tiger, though a lot of people wish to call themselves tigers or whatever. It's an evolutionary backward step. See, nobody calls themselves monkey, but people go further back and say, I'm a cobra, I'm a tiger. It's okay, it's their choice. I have no… individual choices, I have no issue, but it's an evolutionary backward step. Because we realized that this is a superior mechanism or a more advanced mechanism, this is capable of more things, then we realized that we could create many more mechanisms like this. See, suppose if you were made like this tree, I'm not saying that because it's a fat tree, not because of that. Even if you were like this tree, would you have thought up a bicycle? Bicycle is a mechanism that came to your mind simply because you're already mobile. You want to move faster, so you ran. But still it is not good enough, you want to go faster, so you thought up a bicycle. If you were made like a tree, however intelligent you were, you would not thought of a bicycle because it's of no consequence to you. Because you're mobile, you want to go faster, you came up with a mechanism. A mechanism like this or a machine like this he is referred to as a yantra. So we started creating yantras of various kinds. Well, in the physical world, a bicycle, a motorcycle, a car, an airplane, now spacecrafts going elsewhere, all this stuff. But this is in the outer world. In the subjective dimensions, we started creating instruments or machines or yantras. Well, in the northern part of the country, probably this is largely lost except in a few places maybe. Because what you see as northern plains, it doesn't have a single ancient temple left. All of these things were razed to ground during invasions. They've just put up small makeshift temples here and there, and they're managing with that. Only in the Himalayan folds or deep in the east, where invasions did not go, you find ancient temples like Kamakhya or Uttarkashi or Guptakashi. These are ancient temples where invasions did not go. But the rest of the Gangetic plain, Punjab, Gujarat, all these places, totally wiped out. It's only in southern India you really see ancient temples, and in the east like Puri and few other places. Wherever there are ancient temples still alive, you will see in this country, we refer to the deity, or today, because of English language, we started calling it the god as a yantra. This usage of this word is still very much prevalent in southern India. We refer to the deity as yantra. That means we're calling the deity as a machine. We're calling it a machine. Because a machine is just a complex arrangement of forms. A form is a yantra. The basic form was always seen as a triangle. From that we created many complex forms, and we made them function for our benefit. Well, there are many, many dimensions to this. Difficult to explore with the clock ticking. But to put it in the right context, these are dimensions with which you can open up a new possibility, a new window into creation. You are not inventing anything. You are just enhancing your tools of perception so that you can experience and perceive dimensions that you would have not otherwise experienced. Like today with a telescope, you are able to see something that you would have not been able to see with your naked eyes. Well, how do we even know virus exists? A microscope. We are able to see something that we would have not otherwise seen with our naked eyes. 100, 200 or 500 years ago, if the virus came, most people in many parts of the world would believe it's God's wish. God is angry with us and killing us like this. That's what they would think and that's what they thought. Today, because our perception is enhanced with machines that we have created, we know this is a particular type of virus, what is its nature, how colorful it is, you know, everywhere on the television channels, everywhere virus is floating around. We know its form, shape, color, everything. Similarly, in subjective dimensions, we opened up this possibility. In many different ways, this can be used in a very powerful way. This is how the deities came into existence. In that context, I said, we know the technology of God-making. Well, we have Bhairavi, we have Dhyanalinga. Ask people what is their experience of the Devi and the Dhyanalinga. For many people, it's more than their life because it's opened up dimensions that they never imagined possible in their life. Well, there will be people who'll say, oh, what has it opened up? How do you know? How will you know? If I look through the telescope and I say, I see this, 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 I say, no, 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 all you're seeing is you're just having a long metal tube and fooling us. Till you put your eye into it, you don't know. So here, it is not your eye, you have to put your heart into it, otherwise you don't know. Well, anyway, because this needs anything that you see, anything that you realize, today needs authentication from the West. So you have Ramanujam, happened accidentally. Ramanujam, you know, poured out mathematics. People couldn't believe where is this coming from. Because what he said over a century ago, people are still trying to decipher and figure out. He even gave a kind of mathematical backbone to the concept or to the reality of the black holes. When there was no concept of black holes in the scientific community, he gave the math, he just poured out mathematics. People asked, where is this coming from? He said, my Devi bleeds mathematics. He used his Devi to open up the mathematical dimension. If you do not know this, in this culture, for every aspect of life, we have a certain deity for everything. Because the idea was to create, to find access, to create a tool, to create a window, or to create a mechanism through which you could access that dimension of life. So this is a culture where we believed in only one thing, human ingenuity to create many possibilities. There is no looking up and saying, dear God, save me, protect me. This is a recent happening because everybody else claiming our God is taking care of us, you know, we also had to make up something. Otherwise, always you were told, this is your karma. Either you make this wonderful or you make this miserable, it's up to you. There is nobody else intervening with this. It is your karma. Nobody, not your father, not your mother, not your God, not your angels, nobody can do anything to you. You can use all for your well-being, to create well-being, but essentially it's your karma. Your parents are one ingredient, your children may be another ingredient, your spouse may be another ingredient, your temple, your prayer, your mantra, your yoga, or different ingredients of life. You can use this to make this into a wonderful piece of life, or you can use this to make it into a miserable piece of life. So based on this is the science of God-making, technology of God-making. But because of today's silly levels of logic, when I say silly levels of logic, rudimentary kindergarten level of logic is being stretched to everything. This is not being done by the scientific community, this is being done by a whole bunch of idiots who believe they are scientists. All they read is probably high school textbook on science. Beyond that, they have not seen nothing, but they will negate everything because they have such a crude sense of logic. With all your logic, you still don't know what you're made of, what is the nature of your existence. What are you talking about? Because you see everything, you hear everything, you smell, taste everything, just the way this mechanism is made. The parrots are not seeing the world the same way as you see it. The dogs are not seeing the world the way as you see it. They're not even hearing it the way as you hear it. Right here, there's so many creatures who experience the world totally differently. So, right now, your entire... I'm not talking about the scientific community, that simplistic scientists who are all over in the social media, they don't understand, their idea of science is based in the fundamental idea that everything is human-centric. this creation is not human-centric. Both these WhatsApp scientists and the religious people believe that creation is human-centric. It is not human-centric. If this entire solar system evaporates tomorrow, everything will go on fine in this creation. So don't make big fuss about the virus, just stay alive. Stay healthy, stay alive.
Might make a change, rearrange all the bad to okay. Take the worst thoughts saying, turn them to a game. Take the best thoughts saying, put them on display. On repeat in your brain till you're feeling no more pain. Never slow yourself down, you can do some more. Push past all the pain and you'll find a door. Open it up and finally explore everything that you thought you could never do before. And even when you feel low, you can still go. Even when you feel slow, you can still go. Even when there's no hope, you can still go. I never answer to no, man, I still go, go.